Can-bit advanced Glimmer? I guess that would be a topic to focus it more on Glimmer than bits. And I will just a few disclosures, mostly research. And I think it's nice indeed, at least for me, I know most about ASL, to show it in the ASL context as as example. And Patricia actually did most of the work together with us, so she will later show some examples. So I'll give some perspective from the bit side. Most of that is already done. Show how we did it for ASL, and try to open the discussion. But I echo what's been said before, that it's great to see this movement from the not invented here sort of paradigm, where everyone wants to invent stuff himself, to a more open access community where we really share. And if you look at the previous bits documents, it started on Google Drive before it goes to the GitHub for further specification. You really see that the whole world joins in. And that's really nice, because you would think, well, that's going to be chaotic, right? If the whole world is going to contribute to a standard. But it worked, and that's really cool to see. So that's a heads up. This has been described before. So again, it's a quite easy standard to use. I won't repeat that. What hasn't been mentioned yet is in your data set, you have three levels, and they're all called bits because they are specified in bits, and there can be some confusion. So in your bits format, you have your source data, which is the DICOM data coming from the scanner or the XNet or wherever, and can be sorted in whatever structure. It can be a mess, and the DICOM files usually don't have a name of the sequence that they belong to, neither do the folders. So that's your source data, and it's like your vault. That's the original stuff that you got from the scanner or XNet or whatever. Then raw data is your bits files that we just discussed. So it's the raw data before the processing in the bits order. And then the next thing, which is being developing continuously now, is your derivative. So after your pipeline, it's nice to also have a structure. And that's called the structure of your derivatives. And all these things are talked about in bits. So some people would call the raw data bits, but derivatives can also be specified in bits. So indeed, it started in 2015, like Camille said, and fortunately, we unfortunately were last the first author who pulled everything of this to Google. So bits is not Google yet, fortunately, but he's still participating, but he moved to Google. And as Camille said, what you see here is a sort of the whole world collaborating in this effort. But what's good to know, and what a lot of people don't realize, is that the start is coming from the more psychologists and the engineers. So that would do the functional MRI. And so with brain tumors, there could be some functional MRI, but it's mostly structural, quantitative MRI, it's perfusion, metabolic. So it has a slightly different background. You could have more physicists coming into the discussion rather than engineers, and clinicians rather than psychologists. So it's a slightly different community, and specifically with ASL, we've seen that that could give you a different format as we extended bits with ASL. This is the more recent history. So again, in the beginning, it was structural fMRI and DTI, which is your typical functional imaging collective. And then later, so 4 years later, actually, they included EEG and MEG. Then 1 year ago, we got the genetic information, common derivatives, and so the start of having derivatives also in a bits format, which is very similar to the raw data, but you would have like derivatives, free server, and then organized to subject and scan types. Then you have derivatives Explore-ASL, derivative MRI prep. And so it would be similar organized as raw data, but per sort of output. 1.5, so these are all the bits versions of the bit specifications, which Patricia will show more. We got the qMRI, so the quantitative MRI, the T1, T2, T2 star mapping, and ASL. And there's some discussions there, because, for example, repetition time may be something very different for a fMRI or T1 in bits version one, where you just have one repetition time, or to the guys from that do the mapping or that want to do ASL, and you can also change your repetition time. And in version 1.6, we got PET introduced. It was a sort of a battle, and we just won from PET. We were just before them, but it was quite close. And these are examples that are still open. So I guess we could extend this list on the BITS website with things that we find from the Glimmer community should be introduced here. And as you see, this is from scan types that are not there yet, like SWI, to processing derivatives, for example, transformations. How do you describe your transformations from the native to the standard space? Longitudinal registration, as we heard. You could think of ways to standardize this. MRS, we've heard today. So that's yet not in BITS. So exciting work still to do. This has all been set. Why BITS? But I want to echo, if you start out as a junior, having your first PhDs, it can be really tricky if you look 5 years back to data, and the PhDs can actually echo that. That you would think, how did people structure the data yet? And there's like three copies of the data, one for each paper that they published, and it can really be a mess. And we live in a time where you need to be able to show your data to reproduce our findings. And so even if you're in your own lab, and there are people that are telling me, yeah, we will implement BITS in a few years. I don't care for now. I just use my data locally. Even then, it really saves you a lot of time in the long run. And also 80% of the time, if you have your own pipeline, like we have Explore ASL, then pushing the button and letting the processing run is one thing. But before you can do that, you have to spend, and that's mostly 80% of your time. I see again the PhD students smiling because they've only been curating the data. That takes most of the time. And if you have a data format like BITS, and also the BITS validator on the website where you can just upload your data. It won't really upload your data, but it will just look, do you have all the metadata? Is your data format complete? And that's super, because you don't have to find that out after running your processing or even in the reviewer stage. Hey, you know that your data is complete for whatever you want to do. If you come back 5 years later and you want to add a longitudinal design, and that's all because it's such a collaborative worldwide effort. Everything is thought about, so you don't have to reinvent the wheel about what data parameters do I need to include. This is also something that's been said. There's a huge community, so that's what they call BITS apps. So a BITS app is that you take a existing pipeline and you put it into a Docker, and they call it BITS apps because the input is then BITS, and there's also some standardization on how to do it. But some people would just cheat. So for example, if you would look in the fMRI prep, you see that the first part is just converting the data from BITS back into the original data structure that the fMRI guys used. So, and this is a sort of in-between step that we do as well with ASL, that you keep internally, you keep using your old structure, but you make sure that as an input, you can use BITS. But that's the BITS apps. That's actually quite useful also because the output would be more and more in derivatives formats. You have, if you're making your own apps, your own pipelines, there are interpreters, parsers, so PyBITS, BITS MATLAB, the validator, and there's a starter kit. So there's a huge bunch of tutorials and websites and everything that you can just, and this will all be on the website, so you don't have to take pictures, but it's, that's quite nice. So there's, this was a question that was actually raised, and I put it in the presentation. I thought it's really something that a lot of people ask, mainly people from the, that are not using NFTs. For example, DSC and DCE, the perfusion guys, they all use DICOMs. And this is a nice cartoon that says, well, if you have another, you have just another standard. So it starts with 14 standards, let's merge all the standards, and then the 15th standard is the merged standard. So you really need everyone to use the same standard, and that's why it's good that we are trying to adhere to that as well. This is a list that I found with why not DICOM but BITS. So DICOM doesn't have a file structure, adhering to that XNet, for example, which is a very famous archive and database for DICOMs, doesn't have a file structure. It has a lookup table for that. DICOM has a lot of metadata that tells you about the patient study series and stuff, but that needs to be anonymized. And then the way you anonymize that could, you know, anonymize too much, and you throw away data that you need for the processing, which can happen a lot more than you think, or anonymize too little. So that's why it's another reason why DICOMs is very tricky to transfer, whereas in bits, the chance of having any reconcilable data is quite low. With DICOM, it's not really standardized how you could find out what DICOM belongs to what scan type. So usually people have the series description, but you're free to put there what you want. So it could be that the technician says T1, keep your eyes open, or it could be a 3D flare, or it can be anything they put there. And it could be even not there, then it would be protocol data, or it differs sometimes between vendors, between how the vendors export it. This differs between the software versions of the vendor. So it can really be a mess, and BITS was defined as a new standard. Also because it's only for the brain. And of course, if we start to, you know, make BITS larger, it can also become like a bit more difficult to understand. But DICOM is, you know, is like ages back, it was created for multiple modalities, not only MRI, but for any type. So you could even have a CT of the foot, which you won't find in BITS. So it's a huge difference. I already said about this. This is when you go to ASL, we have about 50 flavors, and you would say that it's always the same, but it's not. And at the right, you see that even we have only three major vendors, you can have a lot of software versions on those vendors, and they just change one parameter on how to export the metadata that you need. And as you know, if we go from functional to more advanced MRI, so ASL, CEST and stuff, you need parameters because it becomes quantitative. If you lose a parameter, you cannot, like with a lot of other MRI sequences are relative. If you segment the T1, you don't care about losing some of the parameters. Also what you see in the sequence type here is that if you have a relatively new sequence, then the vendor starts, you know, implementing it on their own with a slightly different readout in this case. And so you can have different readouts. For the different readouts, you need different metadata. So it becomes really complex, and that's why you want to have a standard like BITS. But then the question is, and I will come back to that, are you gonna keep some of these specifics in BITS? And so are you going to say, okay, the BITS would be different for Philips 2D Epi than for GE 3D Spiral? Or are you going to make it equal for all of those? And in one case, you leave some of the specifics in the processing. In the other case, you need to have a very heavy job for the DICOM to Nifty to go from the DICOM to the Nifty to the BITS format. The same as with DICOM is for XNET. Any organ, any modality, no restrictions, and BITS is it's not really flexible. And so you will see with the BITS validator, if you upload any data, it's very structured as it has to be. And it's primarily MRI. So it's extending now, but it started from MRI. This is interesting in respect of Glimmer. So they have now recently from Spain, they came up with MIDS. So instead of BITS, you replace the B from brain with the M from medical. So this includes more modalities, so ultrasound and CT and what's not, and more scan types. And it's also supposed to not only contain the brain. So I haven't looked into it, but it's something that we could consider. For example, CEST or DCE or had these sequences that you see here that are not in BITS yet, they are in MIDS. So we can give that consideration. And again, XNET is something that a lot of people use. It's a lot, every main PI wants to have their own XNET at their site. But XNET is in DICOMs and BITS is in a completely different structure. So that can be difficult, and there are people that are making converters. So in this case, you see XNET 2 MIDS, which is also shown in this preprint. So that's also something to look into. We all have the same problem. So we could also use the same converters from DICOM to BITS. For our own extension, as I said, you start with a sort of Google document. So I think, Cyril started with a GitHub repository, but I think a Google document can be actually easier to start for commenting and stuff before going to GitHub. And one example here is that you see that at the end of that document, you could make green the co-authors that have reviewed it, and then there's a few that are reviewing it or still need to review. So it can be a very easy platform, the Google Docs, and everyone can work at the same time. Some of the take home messages I've covered most of them now. So when you have to go by the BITS principles, and actually they are set out quite nice. So one is adoption. That means that any existing standards you try to adopt. So you have, obviously, in the case of ASL, there were some DICOM tags that have ASL, but mostly all the scanners and the vendors were not using it. But obviously it makes sense to then try to use it. The case of ASL, there was a white paper, and so we tried to start with the sequences described in the white paper and the recommendations described in the white paper. So I'm sure there are white papers as well for other modalities and other scan types. Don't reinvent the wheel. Sorry, I'm mixing them up. What I was just discussing was for don't reinvent the wheel. Adoption is, it's aimed for the user, and actually also it's designed by people that do neuroimaging. The idea is not to make it as good as possible, but rather also to make it as usable as possible. And that gave quite some conflicts in our case, as I discussed. If you have a standard that can have very different inputs, like ASL having a very different layout on each scanner, then it becomes very difficult for the user to put it into BITS. And that can be a friction between the usability and on the other side, the standard. There's the 80-20 rule that sort of matches with the adoption, that you can spend 80% of the time at something that people will use only 20% of the time. So a really exotic parameter or something. And that can actually become 95-5, that you spend most of the time on the things that only a few people will use. And we got this conflict a lot because ASL is also mainly driven by physicists that try to make new exotic ASL sequences. Whereas we wanted to make it easy for the user and just use the clinical ASL sequence that's available at each scanner. So then we had this done, and then the physicist comes, can you please also add that? Then it becomes really tricky. So I think this is also something that's good to realize for glioma MR. So a few things you have to consider then is, are you going to take, in the case of ASL, but could be in any MRI in any case, are you going to keep your data in the original acquisition order, or are you going to put it in a sort of standard order? And in our case, we chose to keep it in the acquisition order. Why? Because if you want to do motion correction, or if you want to know, if I see an artifact, how would that be through time? Then it's easier to keep the original order rather than having to go back to the DICOMs to actually see the original order, even though the order might differ between scanners or whatsoever. I have to keep it short. Okay, I'll stop after this slide. I think this one is then the most interesting one. So ASL is a quantitative technique, like quantitative MRI, there you really have to have the skill slopes. And so if you are losing the skill slope, which is just a few parameters in the DICOM header, by, for example, anonymization, then you cannot quantify your data. So, and the skill slopes are implemented differently by different vendors. So some vendors, they don't tell it to you, so you have to find out, ask Jan where to find it. Or sometimes you, it's hidden in the private fields, or sometimes it's fixed. So we chose to say, okay, in bits, there's no skill slope. So it's you've taken them out, you've applied them, which makes bits more usable, user-friendly, but it makes the conversion from DICOM to bits very non-user-friendly. So these are tricky things, but I think we made the correct decision. But we're still with Chris Rorden going back and forth to actually standardize this, so he can actually get the data into ASL bits. There's a lot more to talk about, but let's keep it there. Oh, it was actually one slide only.